Okay, so I'll just begin with my first question, which is, what is your story in short? So how did you, where did you grow up, and how did you decide that you wanted to do retail?
Well,
maybe how did you just decide that you want to work in retail?
Well, I came back from London, and I'm basically trained as a hairstylist.
Okay.
And I came back from London, and I was in the fashion, hairstyling business, and I couldn't find fashion, really a lot of fashion, you know, items in Singapore. So I started importing in from overseas, from London, and then started selling it. At 21, I started my hair salon. At 22, I started 77th Street. And you know, literally coined the word 77th Street Fashion and Accessories Store, and then eventually grow it during, you know, in the 1980s.
Okay.
Yeah. So I opened 77th Street in 88. Yeah.
Yes.
Hair salon is 87. Yeah.
Okay. So how? What was the challenge in creating a brand? I'm very sure in 1988 the scene was very different from what it is
today.
That's
right. Yeah.
Yeah. But what did you think was the challenge of creating a brand in Singapore?
Well, I would believe the first, you know, in anything that you start, you need to have money. Of course, you need to have, you know, in all things, you need to have your money, you need to have your content, your network, and you need to have manpower. But to create, I think, during the time when you first started, actually, you don't know what is a brand. Anyway,
brand.
What is brand,
yeah.
Right? You just literally get started,
okay.
You just work very hard, and over 20 years, eventually became a Singapore homegrown brand.
Okay.
I think a lot of things you don't really think through. You just really think that you want to import items, open a shop, start a, you know, something, and then you name it something that you really love, which is, you know, I love the number 77, so I literally call it 77th Street, and
okay.
Something easy for people to remember, and then just import in and sell.
Okay.
But I think through time where people grow up, one whole generation of young people have grown up with 77th Street, and they are actually working adults today.
Okay.
And thus, you know, they have all known of 77th Street. So it really takes time to build a brand.
Okay.
I think the most important thing is for you to start up, for you to get started in the first place.
Okay.
And, you know, going forward, you know, for you to really... Today with social media, I think in early days we don't have social media, so it's all by the word of mouth. That's why it takes 20 years. But I think today, with the social media, with you know all the different platforms that you have, it's quicker to build a brand, and you can immediately start something online from your community, from your own attraction of customers who like what you do, and be able to communicate with them, which we don't have when we first started. And today I think there's a lot more opportunity in a social media space to create a brand easily. Yeah. But sustaining a brand really takes time.
Right. That nicely leads to my next question. So it was about the marketing strategies that you used way back then.
Yeah.
And now, how do you think, I'm sure internet has had a huge effect on how you approach your,
yes,
your brand marketing now. So what do you think are the pros and cons of that?
Well, I think in the early days, it's a lot on word of mouth.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of human interaction and customers' trust coming in again and again. You know, customer referring, you know, customers as well. But in the early days, in the 87, 88, when it first started, we are the only fashion, streetwear fashion store, right? And accessory store where we create fashion out of what you love. And the whole aura of what streetwear is about is about the personality and the aura of who you are and bringing up the best in you, right? Even you want to be as quirky, then be as quirky as you can, because that's you. It's about who you are, what you believe in, and bringing the whole essence of the whole being of who you are, and that attracts attention and attracts, you know, people to you. And, you know, it's all a lot of word of mouth. So we literally... you know, became friends with every customer. We know every customer by name. We know, you know, every customer by you know what they do, and they hang out at our shop because rental was affordable. But in time to come, I think social media is able to take over that, because if I want to say something like in this interview, you are able to translate to thousands of people, and you are able to communicate to a whole lot of people to be able to share, which I couldn't in the early days.
Yeah.
I have to do it one by one.
Right.
But today you can communicate. You look at how social media can communicate to millions or even billions of people in 3 days, right? And so I think what we couldn't do in the early days, which is very human interaction, is now able in technology. But of course, in technology-wise, the trust come in being able to deliver your goods on time, being able to, your credit facilities must be able to be trusted on security credit facilities. You must deliver on time as you have promised. You have, everything is very technical based.
Yes.
But I would believe people trust because you are able to deliver, but I think the human interaction is missing. The human touch is missing. For example, in the early days, I have customers who have lost the wallet, and they would come to the shop and say, look, you know, I've lost my wallet, I have no money to go home. And we say, okay, here, take $50 and you know, go home and come back and pay us when you have the money, right? But today, with internet, you can't do that, you know, and you don't have that human touch. So high-tech is great because we are, today, in retail, we are able to sell to the world. So, of course, we have 77street.com that we sell e-commerce to the world. But likewise, you know, I still feel the human touch is not there.
So is it even more valuable today?
I think it has its pros and cons. You have both ways. The pro is, you know, today we are connected to the world, we can sell to the world. Yeah. Someone from India can be buying from us, from, you know, different parts of the world, could be from America, US, London, places that sometimes we don't even know of is buying from us because they don't have such items in their country, but they have internet. Right. Whereas in the physical touch can only be at one transaction point at one time.
Yeah.
So it's very transactional based at one point.
It's very slow.
Yeah. So it's much slower.
Yes.
So you know, you have your good and your bad points. And the good point, like I said, you know, is the interaction. So my staff who have been with me for more than 10 years, you know, they know my customers, our customers know them as well, right? But they are very local. So you know, e-commerce and it's going to be the next big thing in the world. You know, it's transacting at billions of dollars around the world. But I still think, you know, no matter how, there's always people who like the tech part and people who like buying from e-commerce where it's easily accessible for things that you don't get to buy in your own country, or things that you want at a lower price.
Okay.
But versus things that you go to a shop and you really test it out if you really like the product, if you like the feel of the product. So, you know, but in this, I think you will find a space within itself to create enough for everyone to have a part of.
With the technology being.
Yeah.
So what do you think, so my question is about over these 20 plus years, you've obviously done a lot of strategic thinking. So how would you say you built that skill? Or today, how do you think someone can build that skill?
Truly, it's all about experience. Okay. I always tell everyone who is, you know, really on the ground, start as young as you can, you know, and, you know, and today, again, with technology, you are learning, at, you know, you've seen 9 years old, 10 years old coming up with apps and coming up with technology.
Yep.
At 13, they're doing, you know, different things or they're selling and, you know, creating videos and starting companies. Today, you know, it's how early you start, you know, and you gain the experience to make, you know, and go into the marketplace. With the experience, you can learn from a lot of, you know, with, again, social media, where you can have a lot of learning videos, a lot of interaction, a lot of things you can read. You can learn really rich content, but sometimes you also need to, of course, reading is one thing, but implementation and doing it is another. You know, that is all the skills. But I really feel that every young person should start as young as they can, be it at 10 years old. Do something for your parents, for your uncle, for your auntie, your relative, 12, 13, 14. Really get to the ground. You want to be a chef, you want to own a restaurant, start cooking at 10 years old, 11 years old, 12 years old, even, you know, and really learn the skill and go into the internet. You can have thousands of recipes of what people are doing around the world, what kind of food, you know, you could, you know, but of course, like I said, reading and learning from other people's experience is key, but learning on yourself and implementing is even more critical in your success of your career. Yeah, and I, you know, I tell everyone to start as young as they can.
Okay. So my next question is, I work with a big retail brand where I see a lot of young people coming to work as staff, and my biggest problem right now is motivating them. And with all the community work that you have done with young people, I'm sure you've met a big bunch of these people. Do you have any tips for me on how I can really get to motivate these people?
Well, I would believe this generation is a generation that's driven by purpose.
Okay.
You need to show them the purpose. Why are they in retail? Why are they in F&B? Why are they in community? Why are they a social entrepreneur, or why are they professionals? It's to see the future. But a lot of people are just letting days pass because they don't see a purpose in their life, or their purpose is to be a holiday or to get married or something. And then that's their whole entire purpose. So they're not driven by certain things. Yeah. But there are many people, as you are sitting here in this environment, you see they are into retail, they're setting up, they are doing something. As social entrepreneurs, we give them the vision of helping the poor. As entrepreneurs, we give them the vision of starting, taking their ideas into implementation and becoming successful. Yeah. And usually it's not the money, but of course having money is great. You must have money, but the idea of getting your ideas into ideas to implementation and to a reality and to be successful is something that inspire them. So I think we have to really go out there and show them their future ahead, because for what they don't know and they don't see, they don't have a driven purpose.
Understand.
But if they see it, every child, how do we even, if you tell them, hey, look, if you do very well in your running, and they will show you that they can run better. Yeah. You say, hey, you dance well, and then they will dance better for you.
Yeah.
So how do we encourage them, step by step to achieve what they want to achieve, and never fail to also give credit when it's due.
Okay.
As Asians, we tend to put ourselves down a lot more. We don't take, because we think praising a person too much is too,
get to their head. Yes.
So we tend to, try not to praise. But I think we need to also balance that, both praise, but if you need to, maybe give some feedback, give a good feedback where people can improve on it.
Okay.
Don't give a feedback that is almost impossible to be able to manage. But give feedback where you can see a slight improvement on what they're doing.
Okay.
So I think if we show enough purpose to our young people, they can be driven.
Okay.
But for those who don't, I think what I do is I work with those that do, right? And they become role models for those. And then when they look at their peers next to them, hey, how come this person, this girl or this, my friend is becoming successful and he's doing well, they want to do it too. They want to do it too. So using what is real, plus I go around and share about 77th Street and our business to as many people as we can, because from nothing to something, and to build an empire for retail and e-commerce and now logistic business and consulting business. We show it to the young that if I can do it, they can. So, and then to create where Scape, you're at the youth hub, where they all get to start up. How I start up when I first started, it's a little store, serving people, and then they move their idea and we educate and help them to move into the e-commerce idea, to move into the social media idea, to give them the skills, the ability to run a business and management business, and eventually to be successful.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, last before question.
Okay.
Did you have to break any glass ceiling in all these years? Or do you just dismiss that concept?
Every day, every other month, you live and break the norm. You live and break, what you call norm, right?
Yeah.
And you create, innovate, you can, otherwise you stay stagnant. And so every day you break through with, new ideas. But it can be simple ideas, even simple things like, in your everyday life, can you just walk this way different, do something different, wake up, and every day you train yourself, because every day is different. It's like entrepreneurship or, driven people see things that are different. So it's like driving every day. Even though you drive the same way to work, for example, or to school every day, but every day the condition of the car, the driving, the weather,
the situation,
everything is different every day.
Yes.
So how do you then manage every day, yet create, that thinking process every day of doing something different?
Okay.
And I think that is very exciting. But of course, you have people who like to be structured and live every day the same 9 to 5 and everything. You can do what you love best, I think. But for people who are entrepreneurs, who are social entrepreneurs, who are, they like to, break the norm of what it is. The more you tell us we cannot do it, the more we want to prove you wrong. We are delinquents by nature. At some point, we like to say, hey, is there any other way to break this pattern and create new pattern of business, of ideas, of innovations, and plus we provide solutions. We come up with options for solutions, but we hit the wall all the time. So it's always about breaking, not only hit the ceiling, but we hit the wall, we fall down, but we just have this thing in us where we will get up again and again, and despite whatever that happens.
Disruptive thinking,
Okay. Disruptive life as well, not me thinking disruptive life, disruptive, we sleep at odd time.
Okay.
Yeah, but It's never the same.
Alright. My final question.
That's so why that's why your timing is going all the way, all over the place. See, one appointment, two appointment, three appointment, you know?
That's really my next question. How do you manage your time? Or
manage it very well, as you can see. It's because I probably am involved in too many platforms. I have 20 over platforms, from boards to committees to my own business to expansion of the business to everything. But that is also what drives me.
Right.
I think, you know, the day if I wake up and I have nothing to do, I think I would suffer. You know, I probably have a mental breakdown if I don't have anything, you know. And I really enjoy everything. But of course, you know, oftentimes I say I could have worked it better. For example, like your appointment, I say, oh, I could have done it, you know. But, you know, but you never expect the jam, the rain, the thing. Sure. And I said, okay, my timing is like that. We didn't plan it. But, but I want to also say that... because, you know, like someone like us, because when you write an email, it stays there. So, you know I don't have time, but if it stays there, it's going to kind of be in my mind for the next, you know. So I better thought, I better just meet up with you and then this is done, and, you know, and to meet up with you and so that I have one thing done, right? And we measure by the number of things we do. But, you know, I really enjoy it, even though, actually, whether meeting 20 minutes and 1 hour or 2 hours, no difference. Because the minute we get here, it's just the timing to get here. But we are inspired by people like yourself. I think we are inspired by young people who are driven. We are inspired by people who say success. But even those that are not successful have tried. I think we respect those that have tried. You know, I don't think... but those who have tried have then have the experience to take certain things to another level. To know what's going to work. Yeah. A lot of people ask, like you ask, what is your what are good experiences? Actually, the good experiences are all the bad experiences that we go through. And ultimately, we then put it into this thing and say, what is good experience? But actually, it's from all the things that we go through, everything we go through. So I think if you forget about one thing that I would have said in all this interview, what I said is start as young as you can, because experience makes you ahead of everyone else. And also experience is the knowledge that creates the depth of what is to come, even in your studies, in your work, in your travel experience, with that in who you are and who you are going to be for the future.
So, I'm reading this book right now called Talent is Overrated. So, the author essentially says that there's nothing called talent, it's just how much you work hard and how much you do practice. So he even quotes people like Tiger Woods, right? He says his parent, it was his father who coached him from the day he was born to play golf. And that's why he's today a talented guy. So he says that's what talent is really about, how much you practice, how much you work hard. Do you agree with this?
Okay, so it works the same as 10,000 hours principle from Malcolm Gladwell. And I truly believe in that principle, because all of us, let's say tomorrow, you and me, we want to be a chef. And, you know, we go in a kitchen and it's how many hours we can go in to create the food that we want to, you know, we want to create. So it's how fast we can both clock this time, right? How much effort, how much. So it's all down to hard work. I would believe, yes, all of us can start. That's why I'm excited about this 10,000 hours principle, because I never did well in school. But I think coming out to the workforce, I work harder than most people. I work every day. So I work harder than most people, and I'm involved in the most number of activities that anyone could be involved in. And that's where I gained my 10,000 hours to be where I am today for everything that I do. And I realized that I learn more from doing it than reading it, actually. So I encourage, that's why I encourage young people to really come out and do it, right? So I would believe in a principle, but there's always one additional. If you are talented, if you don't practice, you get nowhere. But of course, if you are born with a talent, for example, like singing, you can hit the notes that you want to hit, which no matter how without, you know, hard work you want, if you can't sing, you can't sing, and you can't hit the tune.
There's that little bit
but that is that little bit that brings you into breaking the world record. Yes, though you have talent, he is probably have a certain speck of talent, but through practice, he is able to become number one in the world. Yes. So there is also a certain part of, but many of us are given the opportunity to do well because we spend 10,000 hours, but we may not break the world's record, but we can do it, right? And be above our peers. So thus, 10,000 hours is about 8 hours to 9 hours practice every day. And therefore, Olympics is every 4 years. So no matter who you are, what you are and all that, you will compete every 10,000 hours, every 4 years in the Olympics. Right, it's every 4 years, and thus every 4 years you compete with the rest. But it's that one speck of that extra talent that brings them to break the world record and to be number one for the world.
Okay. Yeah.
But we can all do it if we go out and really work hard and spend 10,000. So in your writing, in your videoing, in your everything, you know, you spend 10,000, you will be one of the best, you know, writer, best, you know, communicator, best, you know, in what you're doing, because you're ahead of everyone. So 10,000 hours is, which means you need to clock your hours as early as possible. That's why I said I emphasize on 10 years old, because by the time you hit, if you start something at 10, 4 years to 5 years, you're 15, and you'll be creating one of the best apps ever, right? If you're at 15, if you want to play, you want to cook at 15, you'll be, you know, or 16, you'll be able to be cooking so well that people will invite you to, you know, collaborate with different chefs and all that. And then by the time you hit 20, 25, you are ahead of your peers. So I believe in the principle that a lot of based on hard work. Where I am today, I'm not smarter than anybody else, but I know I work harder, and you know, and therefore my success today is all about hard work. Yeah, but the experience is the thing that makes me above the rest of my peers.